Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Grunts, All at Sea, written by Philip Ardagh and read by Laurence Boxhall. The dedication reads, "For the real Mimi, a real friend." Chapter 1. A Rude Awakening. "Ugh!" cried Mr. Grunt, sitting bolt upright in bed.
"What is it?"
groaned a dopey Mrs. Grunt, rolling away from her husband and pulling the itchy bedclothes high over her head. This uncovered Mr. Grunt's knobbly feet, waking a single earwig dozing between his toes.
"Someone's stolen all the light bulbs," Mr. Grunt wailed. "We have a thief in the house."
By house, Mr. Grunt meant the extraordinary caravan he and his father, old Mr. Grunt, had made, which was now parked in the overgrown grounds of crumbling Big Manor, a very big house with very few people in it.
"We don't have any light bulbs, you goose gog,"
Mrs. Grunt muttered from beneath the covers.
"Spell it,"
Mr. Grunt blurted out, which seemed to take both of them by surprise. Mrs. Grunt threw back the bedclothes and sat bolt upright next to him.
"What?"
she said.
"Spell goose gog," he demanded. "No rule. We can only call each other things we can spell."
"You just made that up,"
harrumphed Mrs. Grunt.
"It's still a rule."
"Well, it's a stupid one."
"But a rule's a rule, whether you like it or not, trout bag."
"Says who?"
demanded Mrs. Grunt.
"Says me, and I'm bigger than you, and I'm wearing pyjamas," said Mr. Grunt. "So what I say goes."
"Then you won't be saying much from now on, will you?"
snorted Mrs. Grunt.
"How do you mean?"
"If you have to be able to spell it."
"Ha!"
said Mr. Grunt. Mrs. Grunt glared at him with her bloodshot eyes, not that he could see her.
"That's spelled H-A,
he added helpfully. Mrs. Grunt was wishing that she knew how to spell goose gog. She was pretty sure it had a lot of G's in it.
"I'm not playing your silly game, you old boot,"
she bellowed, her yellow and green teeth rattling in her impressively ugly head.
"This is no time to argue," said Mr. Grunt, stretching his arms out in front of him like a sleepwalker. "We've got to find out who stole all the light."
"Haven't you worked it out yet?"
Mrs. Grunt laughed.
"Work what out?"
said Mr. Grunt, because he really wanted to know. You think you know the answer, don't you, dear listener? You think the reason why Mr. Grunt couldn't see is because it was the middle of the night or something, and therefore too dark, spelled D-A-R-K to see. Dark. But that would make Mr. Grunt an idiot, wouldn't it? And anyway, you would be wrong, so there.
"Shall I tell you why you think it's so dark, husband dearest?"
said Mrs. Grunt, barely able to contain her glee.
"Go on, wife," said Mr. Grunt suspiciously.
"Your eyes,"
said Mrs. Grunt.
"What about my eyes?" Mr. Grunt demanded.
"They're closed."
Mr. Grunt opened his eyes and blinked in the morning light.
"Oh, yes," he said, seeming both relieved and satisfied.
Then, moments later, he seemed angry again.
"Why didn't you tell me before?" he demanded. "Why were you keeping it a secret from me?"
Now, Mrs. Grunt could have said,
"Well, you were the ninny with your eyes closed. Why didn't you think of opening them?"
But what she in fact said was,
"Well, you keep secrets from me."
Mr. Grunt threw back the covers on his side of the bed, swung his legs over the edge, and stood up, narrowly avoiding a cluster of melons on the floor. More about those later.
Ah! He cried, like a man who'd just trodden on a stuffed hedgehog called Sharpie with his bare feet.
This was precisely because, gentle listener, he had just trodden on a stuffed hedgehog called Sharpie with his bare feet. He reached down, grabbed Sharpie in one hand, ouch, and threw him slash it across the crammed bedroom of their caravan with all his not inconsiderable might. Fortunately for Mrs. Grunt, because it was her turn to make breakfast, she had moments earlier reached for a frying pan she'd been soaking overnight in a large washing-up bowl full of water beneath the bed to save space. She had just sat up again, dripping frying pan in hand, when Sharpie had come hurtling through the air in her general direction, though she wasn't the intended target. Mr. Grunt had been angry with a stuffed dead hedgehog, not with her. Raising her hands to defend herself, she found herself to be already holding an ideal flying hedgehog repellent and batted Sharpie aside with a frying pan like a tennis player would swat aside an easy ball. The hedgehog shot through the open bedroom window before you could say, "Look out below!" Both Mr. and Mrs. Grunt watched it go in silent amazement. The silence was broken by an "Ow!" Mr. Grunt, massaging one of his hurty, sharply pricked feet, took two hops over to the window and looked out. He saw Sack, the former gardener of Big Manor, rubbing his head. Former means no longer. So Sack was no longer looking after the acres and acres of land surrounding the huge crumbling house. Mr. Grunt laughed and pointed. He loved to laugh and point at people less fortunate than himself.
"What is it, husband?"
said Mrs. Grunt from the bed. She was busy drying the frying pan with a corner of the itchy blanket.
"Sharpie hit Sack," he said.
Mrs. Grunt gave a hideous grin.
"Serves him right," she said.
Mr. Grunt had no idea whether she was referring to the hedgehog or the former gardener. What's more, he didn't care. He had other things on his mind. Mrs. Grunt had been right. He did keep secrets from her. And one such secret was a secret meeting he had to attend in secret later that day. Mr. Grunt found himself sitting in the middle of a round tent, where he'd been told to sit, with light streaming down on him, like a spotlight, from a hole in the roof directly above him.
"Well, can't I sit somewhere else?" he grumbled to the only other person in the tent.
Although Mr. Grunt was directly facing the man, who was also sitting cross-legged and on the rug, the bright sunlight made it impossible for Mr. Grunt to see his face hidden in the shadows. He assumed that this was probably because the man must be really ugly. Not everyone could be beautiful like his Mrs. Grunt. He grinned at the thought of her, adding a worrying-looking smirk to his already worrying-looking face. He sniffed the air with flaring nostrils and dropped the smile.
"This tent smells," said Mr. Grunt,
which was true. It did smell, though a more polite person might have chosen not to mention it.
"The walls are made from animal skins," said the man in the shadows, his voice barely above a whisper. "They have a particular smell."
"A particularly dreadful smell," said Mr. Grunt.
He breathed in deeply, then wished that he hadn't. The smell wasn't as disgusting as Mrs. Grunt's breath. Few things were. But it was pretty rank, in his opinion. Considering most of his meals were made from roadkill, animals scraped off the road having been killed by traffic and left on the tarmac for a couple of days, this was a bit rich coming from him. But that's Mr. Grunt for you.
Ha,
he said. He'd recently started saying
ha
a lot and really liked it. His bottom was already getting numb from sitting awkwardly, so he shifted his weight around a bit.
You could do with some more furniture in this smell trap, you know, he added.
Mr. Grunt found that he'd somehow got his clothes in a bit of a tangle and, yanking his sleeveless sweater out from under his bottom, managed to knock over a small three-legged table with his elbow.
You could do with more furniture, but not so many silly little tables, he snapped.
The man in the shadows gave a little cough. One of those coughs which wasn't really a proper cough at all, but more of a shall-we-get-down-to-business signal.
Shall we get down to business? He said in that whispery voice of his.
I told you.
Oh, yes, a business, said Mr. Grunt.
What had brought Mr. Grunt to the tent was a message. A message that had reached him in most unusual circumstances. The week before, he'd woken up and found it pinned to his chest, well, to his pajama jacket. He knew at once that Mrs. Grunt hadn't put it there. If it had been Mrs. Grunt, she'd probably have ended up pinning him with the safety pin in the process. And then there was the safety pin itself. Unlike the gnarled old ones in her sewing basket, or the pair she sometimes wore as earrings when she wasn't wearing ones made from washers, this safety pin was new and shiny. This was a quality safety pin. Someone must have walked through the grounds of Big Manor, climbed into their caravan, up the stairs, stepped over their sort of son Sonny sleeping on the landing, and crept into their bedroom without waking them, which was quite an achievement. All the more so when you consider that Mrs. Grunt nearly always left Sharpie lying around, like an unintended booby trap of prickles for unsuspecting feet. And you know what trouble that could cause. As for the unsigned message itself, it was written on expensive paper and, although it was in block capitals, it didn't look as if it had been written by someone losing a fight with a pen. No, this message clearly wasn't from Mrs. Grunt. In brown ink, on cream-coloured paper, it asked Mr. Grunt to come to Gilligan's Field at 1 p.m. on Thursday, but that wasn't the part that interested Mr. Grunt. It said that he was to tell no one and to come alone, but that didn't interest him much either. But then he came to the part where it said that there would be silver coins involved, and that did interest him. So, of course, Mr. Grunt told no one, because that meant he wouldn't have to share the silver coins. And when Thursday came, he wobbled away on his trusty, rusty bike and went to Gilligan's Field at around one-ish, where he came across the big, round, domed tent.
I need you to deliver a POGI for me, said the man in the shadows, making the word rhyme with bogey.
Right, said Mr. Grunt. He had no idea who the man was or what a pogie was, but didn't want to ask in case the answer the man gave was a bit boring. He wasn't interested in the details. He was only really interested in the silver coins. Don't get me wrong, Mr. Grunt wasn't one of those people whose life was all about money. He wasn't interested in flash cars or the latest gadgets. But Mr. Grunt had plans. And these plans would be helped along with some silver coins in his rather holy pocket. So, if Mr. Hiding in the Shadows wanted him to deliver a POGI, then he'd deliver a POGI. Full stop.
There are a number of people who want to get their hands on the POGI for themselves. so it's your job to deliver him as discreetly as possible, said the man.
Him? Said Mr. Grunt, raising an eyebrow. The POGI is a him and not an it.
He hadn't been paying too much attention, but enough to hear a him when someone said it, or, to be more accurate, said him.
The POGI is a person of great...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.